Shibe here, here to express my thoughts about the current state of the cryptocurrency space. On this thought, I just wanted to briefly talk about closing the loop. So, with Bitcoin slowly climbing to the 5,000K mark, trading almost close to north of $4,500 per coin, its market values, I believe, surpass PayPal, $7 billion in value. A lot of money has gone into the space in itself. Currently, as we speak, it looks like Bitcoin, the Bitcoin Core, the original Bitcoin chain, is looking more and more like a bear bond than the promise of the initial Satoshi white paper being digital cash, a stored value unit, if you will, that many people are utilizing an investment. You see a lot of investment channels out there talking about investment in cryptocurrency. You're seeing Fidelity teaming up with Coinbase, allowing the option of Coinbase account holders, if they also have a Fidelity account or open a Fidelity account, are able to monitor, trade, and do action through Fidelity. You also see the fact that Coinbase is now a unicorn because it is now valued at $1 billion. Is one of the first Bitcoin cryptocurrency companies have done so. It's also teamed up with a lot of different other financial institutions that are integrating Coinbase into it. You also have a lot of heavyweight investment companies that are stating that Bitcoin should not either be ignored, that people should start looking to invest, or they're already starting to either work with Coinbase or other Bitcoin associated companies in looking into investment. And that's great for the space because right now, currently, at least in the States, there's only really three exchanges. There's the Coinbase one, GTX, Gemini, and Kraken. I guess BitPay to some extent, so maybe four, but really those are the three huge ones. And with Bitfinex rejecting US customers and more cryptocurrency exchanges abroad rejecting U.S. customers, those are going to be pretty much the only places where if anyone wants to get into the space of cryptocurrency, they're going to have to go through those exchanges. And, you know, that's a kind of an attack vector if you think about it, where, you know, central point of entry or central point of attack, where you have the, you know, AML, KYC compliant companies in order to obtain cryptocurrency. Not only that, it limits it in a sense because for those particular companies, they're not trading all the different types of coins that are out there in existence. Like, for example, Coinbase only allows through their Coinbase wallet and their GDX Ethereum, Bitcoin, and Litecoin this time. They're not doing Dash, they're not doing Monero, Zcash, or any of those other coins. And if you're looking to get into those coins, particularly Monero and Zcash for privacy concerns, or Dash because you're looking to do a different type of digital payment platform or digital cash, then you're kind of out of luck in the States. And considering that the United States is a big player when it comes to cryptocurrency, not the biggest player, as we talked about when we talked about China coin, how Asia is pushing a lot of that market with Korea, China, and Japan being the biggest players. And then you have like India, and Australia too a little bit, but India and Singapore really in the Southeast region there coming up fast, approaching in the cryptocurrency space. I think we'll eventually talk a little bit about Korea because there's a lot of interesting things going on in Korea right now when it comes to cryptocurrencies. But what I want to talk about is now that Bitcoin has this significant value, what next? And that has been the question that's been with the community for some time. While there's been a significant amount of merchant adoption, we talked about both the Music and Shy podcast, but through my blog, how this blog, I should say, what was the name of the company? Overstock is holding 50% of any of the cryptocurrencies they obtain, or Bitcoin, I should say, and are holding it. You have companies that are looking to get back into Bitcoin a little bit. As far as accepting the payments, you see more and more merchants are doing so. Japan, because they have now legalized it in their country to where you're able to purchase, use it as a payment platform. There's a lot of companies that have gone on and on-ramped through their cryptocurrency platform in there. The exchanges there have teamed up with payment platforms in that space. China does allow for cryptocurrency payments with different platforms. You have the rise of these Visa cards, these SHIFT cards, where you have the Visa or Master logo on it, but you're teaming up with payment platforms to place your Bitcoin primarily, but also other tokens in there, and swipe to be able to do in-store purchases or even online purchases for merchants that don't directly accept cryptocurrency. But the loop, and what I mean by the loop, I mean it is kind of like the golden thing. If you think about where our economic system is fiat, right? So people get paid through a paycheck. Yeah, it's ones and zeros. You know, it's digital, really. You're not necessarily getting paid in cash unless you have a cash-based job or something of that nature. Maybe you're in the marijuana industry. That's the only industry I can think of off the top of my head that you might be getting paid in cash, except you may be, you know, tipping for, you know, waitresses and stuff like that, but that's in conjunction with a check. Strippers, of course, cash-based there. There's still a few cash-based companies out there, but for the most part, many people receive their funds through their paycheck, their digital paycheck that they receive, whether it be direct deposit or an actual physical check that they either physically walk into the bank, deposit, or put in an ATM machine, or go to a check cashing place because they don't have a bank account, and pay the fee to cash out, if you will. So, if fiat is a thing where everything is paid for, whether it's through paying through cash or through a digital card, cryptocurrency hasn't reached that spot. Now, there's a company out there called Bitwage, and it's not the only one. There's also a European one, and I think also a British-based one, where you can get paid in Bitcoin. You have to set up through your company direct deposit. You have an account with them, and you can put whatever percentage of your paycheck and get paid in Bitcoin. There are different, and I have a link to that company, and also a link to different job boards where you can hang your shingle and do jobs mostly in the tech industry, like software-based stuff, development jobs, and get paid in Bitcoin. You can also sell stuff like through Purse.io, through their Amazon store, or Open Bazaar, or open up, and I have a link of all the things I'm talking about in this episode to get paid and, you know, sell goods and services. There's a lot of website, musicians, things of that nature. These are very small things, but the fact that right now, currently as we speak, people are not getting paid directly in cryptocurrency. So they're not getting paid in cryptocurrency, so they can't pay their bills in cryptocurrency. And the people they pay their bills are not paying their employees or their vendors in cryptocurrency. And, you know, so you're not getting this, like, closing the loop where you're not transferring your cryptocurrency out to fiat so you can pay for your goods right now. Now, there are a lot of ad hoc services out there. There's a few that, a lot of them based in Europe, and again, I'm making the show notes, that do allow for you to pay your bills through them, but they're like a third party. You're not directly as an individual, which what this space is supposed to be about, where individuals have the same control of their wealth and not utilizing third-party services, or at least they have the choice not to. In most cases, you kind of have to use a third-party service. Look at eBay with PayPal, or Visa merchant cards. You couldn't utilize, you know, cryptocurrency or some other payment platform. There's limited choices when it comes to that. But with cryptocurrency, you're supposed to have the power of the individual to be able to choose to use a third party or do things directly yourself and pay for things and goods and services. And I think with the value going so high, and it's going to moon, it's going to hit 5,000, and they're probably going to crash a little bit after SegWit locks in, and then it goes through another bull run. I do think that as a community, as a cryptocurrency, we need to, the next phase really is to focus on closing this loop, focusing on getting people paid directly in cryptocurrency, getting bills paid in cryptocurrency, whether it be your utility bill, whether it be your taxes, whether it be paying your taxes or purchasing your home, whether there have been some direct buys that people have done on a peer-to-peer level, you're not going to Coldwell or I can't think of a big realtor right now, but some realtor agency showing up with Bitcoin and purchasing it. I do think Tesla allowed for a brief period of time, and I'll check into it. You can purchase like one of the latest Teslas with Bitcoin. I know Virgin has, like, if you wanted to go to space, you can purchase a ticket with a Bitcoin, but like hard assets like property, which is very, this is, you know, this is how many people have the wealth that they currently have, is because they inherited a piece of property, whether it be a farm, a business, or a home, either pulled equity to either continue the business or go to college or start a new business or invest back into the property, sell it, buy a new one, things of that nature, or moving up from like a starter home to another home. That's not actually quite occurring right now. There's other aspects of property, like listing it on the blockchain so people know who owns what assets, and that's very important. All these things can be done. I mean, we can do all these things all at once. You know, we don't have to just focus on one thing at a time. But we really, as a community, need to start drilling down and going out there, either like those Kirby vacuum cleaners, start knocking on doors more aggressively and working with state legislators or county legislators or our merchants or business platforms or cities, and going, hey, I have this value here, these coins, whether it be cryptocurrency, Litecoin or Dash or whatever you have, and I wish to purchase or buy this piece of property. I wish to pay my taxes with this form of currency. And I think when we finally start progressively getting into that space, when we start closing that loop, when we start either first getting people paid and directly for investing in companies like Bitwage, allowing for people to be directly paid in cryptocurrency, is going to allow and enable for people to slowly close that loop so that we're not trading out into fiat, and cryptocurrencies can achieve the status of being a global currency. Because right now, with the price that Bitcoin has had and the way, and I have a very significant, if you haven't noticed it through my blogs, a very significant different opinion about the use of Bitcoin of being more of digital cash than a bearer bond or a storage. I think you can do both. Honestly, I do think you can do both. There's a thing called bankable funds. And I talked about it in a blog where, with the way regulations are going, or at least attempts of regulations on cryptocurrency, the way that people are, the existing financial institutions are attempting to attack cryptocurrency, either softly or directly, they're trying to make it, push it to where cryptocurrency's bankability is going to be diminished, where it's going to be like gold and silver. You can hold gold and silver all day and all night, but you're not paying, you know, with a bullion your groceries. You're just not. It's something you hold for, most people are holding like the end of the world or the collapse of the dollar, if you will. Maybe you can, through a peer-to-peer fashion, maybe you can purchase, you know, large amounts of property, if you will, like a house or something of that nature, but for the most part, that's just not happening. You're not buying anything directly with gold or with silver or even platinum. You're just not, that's not happening. Not to mention the transportation of the amount of bullion or silver or platinum to do that, or diamonds for that matter. Diamonds is also utilized in that fashion. But the way, the fact that cryptocurrency, the way it's designed, is digital, you could transport it very easily. We can lose sight of the bankability of Bitcoin. And once the bankability is gone, the bankable fund, the ability to pay for anything with Bitcoin, whether it be, you know, portable coffee. There's a great channel called Bitcoin and Coffee that goes over the investments of the day and the news of the day. I have a link in the show notes, a great YouTube channel. But I might even link a latest video there. If we lose sight of that, if we allow our small, short-term greed, if you will, of having a single coin worth, you know, $5,000, particularly if you invested early and got it around like 200, or you were here from the very beginning and mined it yourself, we can lose the future potential of Bitcoin, the future gains and financial benefits of cryptocurrency, if we don't begin to slowly chip away and begin to really attack the entire overall financial infrastructure. Because it's nice to be able to put assets on the blockchain and know where things are and have that transparency. It's nice to have a very high value coin, if you will. It's nice to even have things like Bitcoin Cash or Dash, Monero, and Zcash the final two for privacy concerns, Dash seeking to be, the digital cash of the internet, Litecoin, everyone's saying the silver to Bitcoin's gold being because of its low value, being able to transact, because it's only like what, $50 a coin right now, maybe a little bit lower than that, maybe around the $40 range. Being able to use that and the low fees and stuff of that nature to be able to transact online. But that's going to be meaningless if we don't have that capability. It's going to be meaningless if we don't have all aspects of the financial infrastructure. And one of those aspects is getting paid in cryptocurrency, paying for things like gas, food, clothes, your taxes, college. I know some of these things are happening in some spaces. There's certain universities are accepting, some of these payments on a small level. But if we don't do this on a global scale, if we're not pushing for this, we're going to get pigeonholed to where these digital assets are going to be digital gold, digital silver, and not have the true unleashing financial power of being bankable and being utilized for anything and everything, because everyone's going to treat it just as a bear bond, as a treasury note, as a gold bullion, and as something for savings and stored value, and not the true potential of a financial asset that can do multiple things at once, be digital cash, be the stored value, be an investment platform, being transparent or not transparent, being a crowdfunding platform, being in something you invest in a business or purchasing property, or being a tax asset and paying your taxes, or something, property that you pass on down through the generations. We will lose that power, and it's very important that we close this loop. Getting paid in Bitcoin, paying your goods and services in Bitcoin. Those people that you pay their goods and services, pay their employees, pay their vendors. It goes back, back up and paying, going back to, whatever it is your employer does, and keep going through this loop and not transferring all that asset out into fiat and back into the cryptocurrency, because you kind of lose some of the wealth, because, of course, fiat is inflationary, so its value diminishes over time, while cryptocurrency keeps going higher and higher, and so you're not going to be able to buy much as much or retain as much of that particular cryptocurrency because of the fiat concerns there. So that's all I have to say. I think that is the next step. I don't think it's really, I do think privacy is important. I think a lot of functionality is important on Bitcoin. I think really, as a community, as a cryptocurrency in the cryptocurrency space, we need to focus on closing that loop. And maybe Bitcoin might not be the asset that does it. It might be Litecoin, it might be Dash, it might be those privacy coins that are out there, like Monero, Zcash. It could be Dogecoin. It could be Ether because of the smart contract component built into it. It could be Bitcoin Cash. There's other coins out there that it could function as that purpose. But overall, I think it's very, very essential for the continuation of this space that we close this loop. And I don't think there's been enough of just dialogue or emphasis or discussion to do so. And I think now is the time. Because within 2 years' time, there's going to be a halving in 2020, whereas we're going to go from 12.5 coins to 6.25 coins is going to be the mining reward. And I think it would be essential and important that by that date, we have a significant percentage, even if it's 1 or 2% of the overall global economy, or even 1%, or even 0.05% of the overall global economy, but like 30% of the cryptocurrency economy, or 40% of the cryptocurrency economy, where people are getting paid in cryptocurrency, they're paying their bills in cryptocurrency, they have closed the loop where they're not transacting out into fiat, they're just living and dealing with cryptocurrency. And maybe we'll see that in spaces like Japan, Singapore, China, India. Maybe not so much India, but maybe because of China and Japan, there might be some influence there in India. But when we really fully begin to see that, when more and more individuals are able to function solely on cryptocurrency, because they're getting paid in it and they're paying everything and doing all their transactions, just within that space alone will enhance and garner power. And not only that, but it will enable and allow for people to achieve mass adoption. It just will happen. It will happen because of that. Because we have closed the loop and it's easier for people to transact and deal on a daily basis without thinking too much about, for most people, about the nature of the blockchain or about their coin itself, because all they have to do is swipe the coin or tap their smartphone or anything like that, and they're able to transact just as they've done previously in the previous economic system with their fiat ones and zeros with the digital coin, the digital dollar with the debit card and checking systems and stuff like that. So that's it for now. Until next time, hey Falcor, what you doing? It's my dog Falcor. Love of my life. No, I'm not letting you outside. She thinks she can get these birds we have out in the backyard. And plus these rabbits with a lot of nature around in my area. So, thank you very much for listening, and to the moon.